back to you. How could we come?
We're about to start church in just a minute. I want to let you know before then, though, that we may well be live streaming today. That means that some of the images and sound from within the room are going to go directly broadcast to the internet. I'm telling you this just in case you have reasons why you don't want your picture to be on the internet. Now, if that's you, you find yourself in one of those circumstances, there are two areas in the building where it's guaranteed we won't broadcast your image. You can choose to sit in the seats over to the right as I'm facing you, or your left as you're walking in near the organ, and make sure you come and go by the sliding doors. Or you can sit in the back of the church near where the baptismal font is, that little area of pews, and leave by the front door of the church. You choose either of those spaces, you'll be out of view of the cameras. Hey, let's get to church now.
Good morning. Great to see you all here. Here's our first song.
I've been wondering lately, am I crazy? crazy to believe in ideals.
What's my scene? Where do I belong? Who do I belong to? Which community will care for me and serve me? It's a great idea and it's a great image to think about as we continue our series on love, sex and marriage. Today we're looking at the issue of LGBT, which is an issue of what is my scene? Where do I belong? Do I belong to a God who loves me and whom I serve? Or do I just make up my identity so as to serve myself and what makes me happy? Joe's going to be continuing our series looking at this issue of LGBT and thinking through deeply what it means to live in God's world as God's people in this area of sexuality. We're going to start this morning's service, though, in prayer by following on the prayer of communion. Let us say this prayer together. Prayer of preparation. Almighty God, to whom all hearts are open, all desires known, and from whom no secrets are hidden, cleanse the thoughts of our hearts by the inspiration of your Holy Spirit, that we may perfectly love you and worthily magnify your holy name. Through Christ our Lord. Amen. Jesus said, love the Lord your God with all your heart, with all your soul, with all your mind, and with all your strength. This is the first and greatest commandment. The second is like it. Love your neighbour as yourself. All the law and the prophets hang on these two commandments. Lord, have mercy on us and write your commandments in our hearts by your Holy Spirit. Amen. Will you stand as we sing our first song, which celebrates the joy of the Christian message? When I survey. Please be seated. Let us pray as we hear God's word, and then I'm going to invite Kathy to come up and read it, and then Joe will come straight up after that. Let us pray. Our Father in heaven, we know your words are true and your words are good. We thank you that you have gathered us to hear those words this morning. And we pray, Father, as you speak to us by the power of your Spirit, you conform us to the image of your Son. May we obey, may we hear, and may we put it into practice in all that we do. And we ask this in Jesus' name. Amen. Thanks, Kath.
Our first reading comes from Romans chapter 1, verses 18 to 32. It's on page 997 of the Pew Bible. For God's wrath is revealed from heaven against all godlessness and unrighteousness of people who by their unrighteousness suppress the truth. Since what can be known about God is evident among them, because God has shown it to them. For his invisible attributes, that is, his eternal power and divine nature, have been clearly seen since the creation of the world, being understood through what he has made. As a result, people are without excuse. For though they knew God, they did not glorify him as God or show gratitude. Instead, their thinking became worthless and their senseless hearts were darkened. Claiming to be wise, they became fools and exchanged the glory of the immortal God for images resembling mortal man, birds, four-footed animals, and reptiles. Therefore, God delivered them over in the desires of their hearts to sexual impurity, so that their bodies were degraded among themselves. They exchanged the truth of God for a lie and worshipped and served what has been created instead of the Creator, who is praised forever. Amen. For this reason, God delivered them over to disgraceful passions. Their women exchanged natural sexual relations for unnatural ones. The men, in the same way, also left natural relations with women and were inflamed in their lust for one another. Men committed shameless acts with men and received in their own persons the appropriate penalty of their error. And because they did not think it worthwhile to acknowledge God, God delivered them over to a corrupt mind, so that they do what is not right. They are filled with all unrighteousness, evil, greed, and wickedness. They are full of envy, murder, quarrels, deceit, and malice. They are gossips, slanderers, God-haters, arrogant, proud, boastful, inventors of evil, disobedient to parents, senseless, untrustworthy, unloving, and unmerciful. Although they know God's just sentence that those who practice such things deserve to die, they not only do them, but even applaud others who practice them. Our second reading comes from 1 Corinthians chapter 6, verses 1 to 11. It's on page 1014. Yes. If any of you has a dispute against another, how dare you take it to court before the unrighteous and not before the saints? Or don't you know that the saints will judge the world? And if the world is judged by you, are you unworthy to judge the trivial cases? Don't you know that we will judge angels? How much more matters of this life? So if you have such matters, do you appoint as your judges those who have no standing in the church? I say this to your shame. Can it be that there is not one wise person among you who is able to arbitrate between fellow believers? Instead, brother goes to court against brother, and that before unbelievers. As it is, to have legal disputes against one another is already a defeat for you. Why not rather be wronged? Why not rather be cheated? Instead, you yourselves do wrong and cheat, and you do this to brothers and sisters. Don't you know that the unrighteous will not inherit God's kingdom? Do not be deceived. No sexually immoral people, idolaters, adulterers, or males who have sex with males, no thieves, greedy people, drunkards, verbally abusive people, or swindlers will inherit God's kingdom. And some of you used to be like this, but you were washed, you were sanctified, you were justified in the name of the Lord Jesus Christ and by the Spirit of our God. This is the word of the Lord.
Well, someone suggested the song for the day be Hot Potato, Hot Potato by the Wiggles. But let's pray. Father, we want to commend our ways to you and our time. We pray that the words of my mouth and the meditation of all of our hearts might be pleasing in your sight. Amen. Well, there's no doubt that in terms of human sexuality, that we are in a period of sweeping changes in the West that are coming with increasing speed, and that boundaries are not just being pushed, but we are seeing the complete overturning and reversal of society's opinions from the past on major issues. Homosexual activity was illegal in this country until the mid-90s. But as of 2017, not only have we legalised gay relationships, but we've legalised gay marriage and said it's a good thing. And now the big debates in the news and in the schools and everywhere are over transgenderism. And with each sweeping change, we've seen greater and greater chaos and greater division in our society and in our institutions. And in families, with some embracing the changes, others opposing them, others deeply confused about what to think, and with much hurt on every side. And the Anglican Church isn't immune, as proven in the last couple of weeks by the creation of the Diocese of the Southern Cross, which has come about because conservative Christians with conservative views have been pushed out and silenced by the dioceses they were part of, and it's a way of caring for them and protecting them. Today we're looking at what God has to say about human sexuality, and in particular the letters we're increasingly familiar with, LGBTQI, and with more letters added regularly, hence the plus that you often see at the end. And Christians are wondering all sorts of things when we're confronted by the letters, the media and everything else. What's it all about? What's behind it? Why now instead of the past? Is God for any of it, for some of it, for none of it? Is he opposed? How should we react? How do we minister to those who are going through same-sex attraction issues or gender identity issues? And what do we do if we're struggling with some of these feelings ourselves? Will Jesus accept me? There's often guilt and shame. How do I deal with it? What's the way forward? Well, before we get into all that, let me preface what I've got to say with a couple of things. You need a disclaimer sometimes, don't you, Aaron? He was showing me one this morning. Firstly, there may be some who find what we hear today quite difficult, perhaps because this is something that you're struggling with personally and it's been a secret and it's been a struggle in the past and it hurts. There's also those here with friends and family who are going through one or more of these issues, and so it's hard, particularly when there's anger and guilt and frustration. I get it. I've been there. I've had several friends who've gone through these things. Some are still facing them. I once buried a gay man who committed suicide and had to counsel his boyfriend through the grief. And I know in the midst of pain that it can be hard to hear the word of God. But then secondly, I also want to preface this talk by saying that it's very difficult to say anything comprehensive in one Sunday sermon. The changes are so rapid, the issues are so complex, the rhetoric keeps changing, and the various groups identified by those letters are not the same as each other, have different issues, and while the letters are all lumped in together, they're not as cohesive a group as it might seem. For instance, the letter I, which sometimes appears and sometimes doesn't, stands for intersex. Intersex are a group of people for whom something's either gone wrong in the fertilisation of the egg that they were produced from, or in the gestation period, so that their genitalia is ambiguous, or they have confused chromosomes like XXY instead of XX or XY. And so there's something medically wrong. And most people in the I group hate being lumped together with all the other letters. So we're not really dealing with that today. But even amongst the others, there's plenty of disagreement. J.K. Rowling, Harry Potter writer, is a strong feminist. She's pro-gay, but she's been censured and vilified for her anti-trans statements. On the other hand, there's now church leaders who are pro-trans but anti-gay because they say gender identity dysphoria is nothing to do with sexual activity necessarily, and say, what's wrong with that? So it's impossible to say everything about everything. And so all I want to do today is to create a framework for us to be thinking and have conversations about. And we're really going to focus on LGBT, that is lesbianism, women with women, gay, men with men, bisexual, someone happy to go with either or both, and transsexual, identifying as the opposite gender to your body's biological sex. So here's how I plan to proceed. First, I want to summarise what the mood of our society is around LGBT issues, and I'm sure that you'll agree that that is what the message is. Then I want to look at what God has to say in the Bible about human sexuality and then ask, why does he care about it at all? And then finally, I want to talk about how do we care well for people dealing with these issues themselves. So what is society saying at the moment about LGBT? Well, there's lots of popular opinion going around. It's commonly held that if you are LGBT, it's because you were born that way. It's genetic, and so you can't help it. It's commonly held that it is impossible to successfully struggle against LGBT feelings and that you should just give in to them, embrace them, because that is who you really are deep down inside. That's the most important part of your humanity. There's a common perception that LGBT people have just as long and loving and stable relationships as anybody else in the community, and that embracing the lifestyle makes you a lot happier. LGBT people might even be considered to be better adjusted than most straight people. They're better at doing life. They're certainly sharper dressers. In fact, the image portrayed in 2022 that to be LGBT used to be, I quote, on the cutting edge, to be hip, to be an individual, to be part of the glitzy yet sensitive culture that represents all the best in humanity's evolving nature. And the Sydney Gay and Lesbian Mardi Gras is the public demonstration and promotion of it. It's all about fun, it's about being free, it's about celebrating and embracing your humanity. And on the other hand, if you oppose or question LGBT in any way, then you're labelled as a dinosaur, a bigot, a homophobe, a hater. You might hear Christians described as hating gays. But worse than that, you're considered an abuser. And no one wants to be an abuser these days, do they? Because you're harming others because you do not approve their choices. You oppose freedom and expression. You oppose natural human instincts. You oppose reality. And in so doing, you dehumanize the LGBT people because you're attacking their fundamental identity, which is the ultimate sin. Because to claim something as your identity is to define who you are and give you validity and a place and a way of fitting into the world. So to question someone's identity, well, you might as well have murdered them. Indeed, you are a murderer because your opposition is causing people to kill themselves, commit suicide, which is the end of all arguments, isn't it? Since you whacked that out there, how can you say anything anymore? And I know several people in our congregation have been told that to their faces by their loved ones. Do you want me to kill myself? How can you answer that? Now, those are horrible and scary things to be accused of. So you can understand why so many institutions and companies have gone out of their way to publicly embrace LGBT rhetoric, because they don't want to lose customers. They don't want to alienate clients. They don't want to lose business and money, which is really what's happening in the liberal church, which loves to be praised by the world and so preaches whatever's popular in the name of relevance, proclaiming itself as the loving church because it embraces anything and everything. Yet, while the Bible certainly is pro-love and all for kindness and gentleness and patience, that doesn't necessarily mean that God's okay with everything or that anything goes. So, what does God have to say? Is the Bible clear on these matters or not? Because you've got bishops and ministers claiming that the Bible says nothing about these things at all. Or that, you know, it might mention it here and it seems anti there, but it's unclear, it's inconsistent, and you can find other verses that are pro. But the Bible's very clear and totally consistent. Let's start with the Old Testament law, which the Jews call the Torah, the first five books of the Bible, Genesis to Deuteronomy. It's called the law, and I think that's a bit of a confusing term because you hear law and you think commandments, don't you? And while it is filled with commandments, there are plenty of them there in the law, it's more than that because the law also gives you background and patterns which provide the shape of things, the stories of the history of Israel and so on, which when the laws come, give firm boundaries and clarifications to the patterns that were there beforehand. And so when it comes to human life and sexuality, the law begins with the pattern that we've seen several times already these last few weeks. At the pinnacle of creation, God makes a man and a woman, both equally loved and valued, both are made in his image, and they are made for each other with all of their differences. And they are very different. Wonderfully different, different roles, different hormones, different physically, and only together can they fulfill God's purposes for them of filling the earth and subduing it. And part of the difference between the man and the woman is that they are engendered people, made with bodies to suit their roles and their function in God's creation, engendered in a way that's delightful to God and to each other. And so we hear the pronouncement in Genesis. Oh, I'm going to do something with this. I mean, what are we going to do? In Genesis chapter 2, for this reason, a man shall leave his father and mother and be united to his wife, and they shall become one flesh. That's the fundamental pattern God gives of family, of one man, one woman in a sexual union to the exclusion of all others, where they leave one family to begin another one. And then the commandments of the law all fit that shape. They spell it out, they define it, they put limits around it. And so in terms of sexual activity, what are some of the commands of the law? Well, here's a famous one from the Ten Commandments: do not commit adultery, right? Which reaffirms the pattern of exclusivity. It's these two together for life, right? That rules out bisexuality, where you're sleeping with multiple people automatically. You must not marry or have sexual relations inside the family that you were born into. And Leviticus 18 spells out what that means. There you go. There's the people you can't sleep with or marry. I'm not going to read out the list. I did note that one of our members says, I notice it doesn't say cousins. That's okay. Anyway. And God explicitly rules out other sexual relationships that are outside of that basic pattern, right, within the laws. And so that's in Leviticus 18. In verse 22, he goes on to say this: do not lie with a man as one lies with a woman. That is detestable. Or in verse 23, he goes on: you are not to have sexual intercourse with any animal, defiling yourself with it. A woman is not to present herself to an animal to mate with. It is a perversion. And there you go on a porn site, and that is an option you can view. All right? So it's not that God's unaware that any of these things could happen or did happen, or that he's completely unaware of what goes on in the world. Notice verse 24, where he says the nations, they do all of these things. But he's saying, don't do it. And homosexual sex is a part of it. It's not the only thing, but it's part of the list. Same goes with confusing the genders. And so Deuteronomy 22 verse 5, this law appears, a woman must not wear men's clothing, nor a man wear women's clothing, for the Lord your God detests anyone who does this. Again, he's not unaware that people are doing it. He's not saying that people out there in the world don't do it. He's saying you shouldn't. It's a boundary that God puts in place to reinforce the pattern. Don't present yourself in a way which might confuse yourself or others as to whether you're a man or a woman. Instead, what are we as creatures of God, made in the image of God, meant to be doing? Well, we're meant to thank God and delight in his creation of ourselves, of others. And so we see it's not just an Old Testament thing. The New Testament says exactly the same things. And so on homosexuality, we just read Romans chapter 1 and 1 Corinthians 6. Both passages talk about humanity in rebellion against God, and they lump homosexuality in with all sorts of other sins that people commit in their denial of God. That is, homosexual sins are not the only sins, but they are certainly there. And the idea of gender clarity in how you present yourself based on how God made you biologically is in the New Testament as well as the Old Testament. And so 1 Corinthians 11, for instance, will go on to say, don't confuse your gender and by your presentation of yourself by your hairstyles and by what you wear. Women are women, men are men, and how they express themselves and identify should fit in with God's creation and be celebrated. So it's clear that the Bible speaks clearly about it, right? And consistently about it. But the question you might have is why? Why would God care about any of it? Why would he make rules? Why make a pattern? Why put limits? And I want to say he cares for two very important reasons. One we're not going into today, which is because human marriage and relationships are designed to be a pointer towards God and his relationship with us. But I'm going to leave Adam to talk about that in a couple of weeks' time. Don't want to steal his thunder. But God also cares because he made us. He loves us. And he knows what's good for us better than we might even know for ourselves. When God sets things up the way he did, he designed it so we could flourish as people in relationship and fulfill his purpose for our lives. And to step outside his pattern is bound to be a recipe for pain and hurt and disaster. Whether it's adultery or pornography or sleeping around or prostitution or embracing the LGBT lifestyle, it's always going to bring pain and despair, as the real statistics show, as we're going to see shortly. God's ways work. But why is it so hard to believe that? Or that God has our best interests at heart by the way he designed things? Well, it's hard because of sin. Sin is that attitude that we want to make up the way things are and run life our way. You think back to the original sin. It seems like such a small thing that Adam and Eve did. Right? It's eating a piece of fruit that they weren't supposed to. Big deal, big whoop. What's wrong with that? What's the harm? Well, it wasn't just that they defied God, which would be bad enough because he said you must not do it. But they were taken in by the devil's lies, and they ended up setting themselves up as authorities over God. They wanted to be determiners of their own identity and destiny. That's what sin is all about, and we all do it. We want to create an identity for ourselves other than the identity which is given by and found in God. And we end up misidentifying ourselves in a whole range of ways, not just sexually, but all sorts of ways. And when we misidentify ourselves, and others, we misuse his gifts and we do great harm to ourselves and others physically, emotionally, sexually, intellectually, spiritually. And that is why God detests it, right? Because it's denying his goodness, it denies his identification of us, it denies the brilliance of what he made. It denies that we are made for his joy and glory and purposes, and it brings real hurt. So let's go back to some of the claims that the world's making about LGBT and see if they hold up. The claim that LGBT people are born that way and you can't help it. Well, the overwhelming evidence is there is no genetic correlation. The one study that concluded that there is a correlation back in 1993 has been completely debunked as fraudulent. In fact, when it comes to gay men, for instance, in 90% of cases, the roots are well known and can be traced to the sinful actions of another person or people. And the story is generally the same, and I've heard the same story over and over again from people who shared, you know, I'm so glad for the conversations and the sharing, but the pattern's the same. Physically or emotionally absent father, sexual abuse by a close relative or an authority figure, such as a scout leader, a teacher, or an older kid at school. And so the poor kid grows up with a weird and warped views of relationships with men, having endured something they should never have had to. Which has been story after story for the dozen or so men I've had this conversation who've been openly gay but also willing to share with me about their life. All of them fit that. In terms of gay men having happy, loving, long-term relationships, well, hundreds of studies were conducted by people who were pro-gay or neutral to it, who didn't care what the answer was. Here's a summary of the findings. Suppose you were to move into a large house in San Francisco, which is regarded as the gay capital of the world, with a group of 10 randomly selected homosexual men in their mid-30s. The relational and physical health of the group would look like this. 4 of the 10 men, so 40%, are currently in relationships, but only one of those has been faithful to his partner, and he will not be within a year. 4 have never had a relationship that lasted more than a year, and only one has had a relationship that lasted more than 3 years. 6 are having sex regularly with strangers, and the group averages almost 2 partners per person per month. 3 of them occasionally take part in orgies. 1 is sadomasochistic, 1 prefers boys to men. 3 of the men are currently alcoholics. 5 have a history of alcohol abuse, and 4 have a history of drug abuse. 5 regularly use at least 1 illegal drug, and 3 are multiple drug users. 4 have a history of acute depression, as compared to 3% of the male population in general. 3 have seriously contemplated suicide, and 2 have attempted suicide. 8 have a history of sexually transmitted diseases. 8 currently carry infectious pathogens, and 3 currently suffer from digestive and urinary ailments caused by these pathogens. At least 3 are HIV infected and 1 has AIDS. In terms of transgender, the correlation with other comorbidities, as they're called, is staggering. American doctor Lisa Lippman has been studying what she has described as rapid onset gender dysphoria. That is the massive avalanche of teens and early 20s, particularly women, who are coming out as trans in the last 5 years across the West. She did a study involving 256 teenagers. 48% of the group had experienced a traumatic or stressful event prior to the onset of gender dysphoria. They weren't confused before. Something happened, and then afterwards they started having these issues because of the trauma. 45% were engaging in non-suicidal self-injury prior to the dysphoria, cutting and so on. 15% were diagnosed with ADHD, 12% with OCD, 12% were on the autism spectrum, 7 had eating disorders, 7 were bipolar. In other words, for many of these children, teens, it was these other comorbidities, to use the technical term, that were in fact the real issue. And in fact, needed to be treated for stuff. They needed counselling and help. Abigail Schreier, a non-Christian journalist, has written a book, Irreversible Damage, showing the terrifying effects on mental health and physical health that trans hormone therapy and surgery has. Preston Sprinkle, in his book Engendered, says, in the conversation about trans suicidality, ignoring the prevalence of co-occurring mental health concerns and laying emphasis exclusively on transitioning may seem caring and respectful, but it does no favours to the trans community. In a world filled with advertising and manipulation, where people are so easily influenced in all sorts of areas of their life, and where to be different, you get praised and held up as a hero, why would we think that the issue is the body rather than the mind? God cares about people. One of the lies that activists perpetuate, and it is a lie, is that if kids aren't allowed to transition, then they're going to kill themselves. It's the weapon that's waved every time. It's part of the script that activists teach young people. Not only is that an evil, reprehensible thing to say, because anyone who knows anything about suicide knows that you do not plant the seed in someone's mind, but the studies are showing it's just not true. More people are treated for severe anxiety disorders after trans surgery than those who had issues but never went through with it. And do you know when the peak suicide ideation period is for people experiencing gender incongruence? It's 7 to 10 years after having surgery, gender-affirming surgery. That's when people are killing themselves. And now there is a massive movement of people detransitioning. There's a Reddit group, which is an internet discussion, of 34,000 people who've had reverse surgery to go back to how they started, which is never the same because you've had a mastectomy and then you get a silicon implant instead or other stuff. What about the claim that people can't change? They just can't. It never happens. That's not true either. People change all the time. Into, out, across. There's gender fluidity is one of the letters that we're not talking about today. And so it happens all the time. And some of us have seen our friends and family go through it, right? That they were heterosexual. They then were experimenting. They then were said they're pangender, then transgender. Now some say they've gone from being a woman to a man. And so now I'm a gay man, a gay trans man. Right, so, like, of course people change. They change all the time. Moreover, it's been established by numerous studies that a huge percentage of children and youth who experience gender dysphoria, about 80%, desist over time. They resolve their gender conflicts. And I personally know of several gay men who are now happily married heterosexuals with great families and healthy sex life. David Old's twin brother has gone on public record to talk about it. On SBS. Now, I'm not saying that there are easy solutions or instant changes or that even conversion therapy is good or effective. There's some horror stories from there too, and I'm certainly not saying that if you have issues and you talk to someone, everything will be honky-dory and your feelings will suddenly change and you'll live happily ever after. Life's much more complicated and messy than that, isn't it? But what I'm saying is that people struggling with same-sex attraction or with gender incongruence issues do not need the LGBT lobby pressuring them and lying to them that there's no future without embracing the lifestyle. You come to 1 Corinthians chapter 6 again, that passage we read, which lists homosexuality among the sins, which mean that you're living outside God's ways and you're not welcome in his kingdom because God takes sin very, very seriously. But did you notice the last bit in verse 11? And some of you used to be like this. This is what some of you were, the other translations say. But you don't have to be locked in to the patterns of sin in the past. That is what some of you were. But,
And here's the beautiful thing. You were washed. You were sanctified. You were justified in the name of the Lord Jesus Christ and by the Spirit of our God. Washed. The dirt of the past was swept away. Sanctified. God changed you. And he views you as holy, and he is at work in you now, changing you and calling you to live for him and be holy in his sight. And you were justified. You were declared not guilty of things that you were guilty of. The gospel of the Lord Jesus Christ brings all of those things. Jesus died for us so that we might be forgiven and restored. Any change that God makes in us might be long. It might be slow. It may never reach its conclusion in this life. But the promise here in 1 Corinthians 6 is that there is healing. That's why Jesus died. That is what some of you were. God cares and he works to bring healing. And that's why we should care too. But how do you care well? You've got someone in your life with an issue like this. How do you care for them? Well, I haven't got all the answers. And I'm sure I've made plenty of mistakes. But here's five things to reflect on. Firstly, people with sexual and gender identity issues are so vulnerable on multiple fronts. They're vulnerable to the lies of activists. They're vulnerable to being manipulated by people. They're vulnerable to being used and abused. They're vulnerable to false solutions. They're vulnerable to self-harm if they buy into the narratives. But they're also potentially vulnerable to us who might be seeking to care if we're clumsy or we rush in with all guns blazing. Second, because of that, we have to learn to listen and listen with love. We are dealing with people in pain, and we need to hear their cry and sympathize and walk alongside them. It's hard to do. And it may be a very long road, and there's going to be a real emotional roller coaster to ride with them. Thirdly, though, we need to walk in wisdom. You know where God says wisdom starts? Well, Proverbs says the fear of the Lord. James says it starts with prayer. Now, if any of you lack wisdom, he should ask God, who gives to all generously and ungrudgingly, and it will be given to him. We really do need to start on our knees in prayer, don't we? Because wisdom comes from above. And God is great, and he loves us. And he not only gives wisdom, but by prayer he can, and he has, and he will work incredible things, even things we think are impossible. God changes lives. I've seen it many times. So start with prayer. Fourthly, walking in wisdom also means seeking advice. Usually we don't have the answers ourselves, and getting help from people who've been there can really help. There's lots of good help out there to get, and there are lots of excellent resources available. Walking in wisdom will also mean not affirming everything that you will be asked to affirm. And it may well bring anger and frustration and name-calling as a result, but you've got to work out what you can go with and what you can't go with, and go with the things you can go with. All right? But you need to set boundaries yourself so you can interact respectfully, and they can too. But finally, walking in wisdom means we've got to be very, very clear about what our goal is. The goal is not to get someone to pretend to themselves or to others that there is no struggle. That is not the goal. The goal is not to get them to have heterosexual sex with someone. It's not to get them married off properly. No, our goal has to be God's goal, doesn't it? What is God's goal? We want to present every person mature in Christ. That's our church motto, Colossians 1:28. That's our goal, isn't it? Presenting people mature in Christ. And so even more than helping others make wise decisions about their gender conflict or sexual struggles, we want to point them to Jesus Christ and his wonderful gospel of grace and life and forgiveness. We want to see them one for Christ. We want to see them growing Christ. We want to see them serving others in the name of Christ. We want them to see their identity in Christ, for that is the only identity which will ever give true meaning and lasting joy and real peace. Let's pray. Father, these are complex issues, but we thank you for the clarity of your word and that you really do love us. We pray that you would have mercy on us as we care for others, and you might have mercy on our LGBT friends and family and those who are struggling, so many in the community. We pray, please, Father, that the lies would be exposed. We pray that your grace would come, that the Lord Jesus would be honoured, and you would help us as we stand up for you and stand firm in our convictions to be loving, kind, wise as we deal with this and as we walk alongside people who are struggling. Please, Lord, be with us. In Jesus' name, amen.
As Joe has said, certainly our goal is to glorify Christ in all that we do. Let's stand and sing our next hymn, which talks about exactly that. All glory be to Christ. Will you please stand?
To you, who goes to my
Please be seated. We're going to spend some time in prayer in a moment, but first, just some quick announcements. The first one has to do with Father's Day. If you are a father today and you're here as a father, happy Father's Day. I have a special gift for all of those. I, as a father, got wonderful presents, socks. And because I've got new socks, I'm willing to give away my old ones. So if you need some socks, please come and see me and receive your free socks today. Second thing, Joe has raised some big issues today, and you might have questions for Joe that you'd like to ask. Well, in a couple of weeks, we've got a special church service where we're having Roast the Rector. We're organising the spit. We'll get Joe up. We'll spin him around a few times. It will be lots of fun. But if you have questions, now's the time to take the comment card and write those questions down that you'd like Joe to answer on that day. So it would be a great opportunity to think through more deeply or have specific questions that you want answered. Joe will happily do that on that day. So if you've got those questions, write them down today and submit those so that we can Joe can start thinking through some answers on that Roast the Rector. And that's coming up in a couple of weeks. And finally, just to those who gave a hand out yesterday to the Working Bee, awesome job. I was amazed at how quick and how good the gardens look. Done a wonderful job. So thank you for those who came. The next one will come up very soon. It will be a great chance for you, if you missed out, to help out with the weeding. And there's also a stump that Al Doran and I were digging out yesterday. If you're good with a mattock or shovel, that is the job for you, because we've still got to keep on going. So please look out for that. So let us spend some time in prayer to our great God and Father who has given us so much. Let us pray. Our Father in heaven, we thank and praise you for who you are. We thank and praise you that you are our Father in heaven, that your name is holy and that you have loved us so much through your Son, our Saviour Jesus Christ. We thank you, Father, that though we as well once lived in the world, acting and following our own passions and our own desires, our own sinfulness, that in your great mercy, through the blood of your Son, you have washed us, you have sanctified us, you have made us clean. We pray, Father, as people who are sinful, who have committed many sins in the past, that we keep coming to you, remembering of the great joy of salvation. And that as we take the gospel out, Father, that in your mercy we will do so with patience, forbearance, kindness, gentleness and love, respecting and fearing you, respecting and caring for others, so that they also, in their hurts, in their pains, in their desperate need, will come to trust in Jesus as Lord and Saviour. Give us great grace, Father. Give us great boldness. Give us great courage. But most of all, Father, give us great love and desire to see other people know the goodness and the grace of your Son, Jesus Christ, our Lord. Amen. Father, we do give you great thanks for the camp that was on last week. We thank you for all those who attended. We give you great thanks, especially for John and his wise words as he spoke at the camp. We thank you, Father, for the encouragement to evangelize and the message that evangelism is not just set aside for the professional ministers, as it were, but it's a job that we all can do by taking out your word. We pray, Father, that we will take out your word to this community. We give you great thanks for Ingleburn, for Glenfield, for Macquarie Fields. We thank you for the parish that you have put us in, and we pray, Father, as it continues to grow, that you will give us eyes to see the lost and a real desire to go out and reach them. We pray, Father, you'll raise up workers for the harvest. We pray as we go into all these different areas, into the schools, into the university groups, into our local sporting or hobby associations, that we will go and be Christians, that we will identify as Christians. And as we identify as your people, that people will ask us for the reason we have the hope within. So we pray, Father, that we'll use the camp and the encouragement of the camp
as we built relationships with each other, to be open to sharing those relationships and bringing other people in to know you. Father, we give you great thanks for our youth group. We give you great thanks for Steve Gangemi, who continues to lead that group. And we pray for the leaders. We pray for Mitch, for Sam and Rebecca. We thank you for them, and we thank you for their service of you. We thank you for the way the kids respond to them, and we pray, Father, the youth group will continue to grow. Pray as the kids come along and think about the gospel and think about Jesus and how they are to relate to you in their situation, especially as young people growing up to know the Lord Jesus. We pray, Father, they'll be faithful, that as they listen to the leaders, that they will hear Jesus so clearly taught, that they will respond to him. We pray for the leaders as they continue to write and think through studies. Give them great wisdom, give them great boldness. Really, Father, give them great clarity to teach faithfully your word in a way that is engaging and helpful for those students. Father, you are a great God, and we do give you great thanks for the youth group and the fun we just have. And we pray, Father, you'll just continue to be with the youth group and the youth group leaders as they continue to serve you. And finally, Father, we pray for Scripture. We give you great Scripture, give you great thanks for the Scripture that is taking place, our ability to still take the gospel into schools throughout the week. We give you great thanks for our leaders. We thank you for Mick, for Trudy, for Kim. And we pray also for Lachlan, who does the high school scripture at Ingleburn. We thank you, Father, that scripture is growing in Ingleburn High School. We thank you for the new enrollment process that has taken place there and the many more kids who are actually involved in coming along to scripture. We pray, Father, we'll be able to reach out and leverage that group in such a way as to bring more students into our youth group or into other activities throughout the week that they might hear the gospel. Father, help us to think clearly about how to use the opportunities that you have presented with us in such a way as to see many people come to know Jesus. We know all glory belongs to Christ. May we live that glory out. May we praise him and work to serve him in all that we do. And we ask these things in Jesus' name. Amen. We're going to do Form 4 of the Lord's Supper today. If you want to follow on, you can follow on page 66 of the communion books. And I'll be starting at the top of that page at point 1. The Apostle Paul indicates the significance of eating and drinking together in remembrance of Jesus and his sacrifice in this way. It's not the cup of thanksgiving for which we give thanks a participation in the blood of Christ. And is not the bread that we break a participation in the body of Christ? Because there is one loaf, we who are many are one body, for we all share the one loaf. Whenever you eat this bread and drink this cup, you proclaim the Lord's death until he comes. But these promises are accompanied by a warning. Whoever eats the bread or drinks the cup of the Lord in an unworthy manner will be guilty of sinning against the body and blood of the Lord. Everyone ought to examine themselves before they eat of the bread and drink from the cup. For those who eat and drink without discerning the body of Christ eat and drink judgment on themselves. So let us confess our sins and our need for forgiveness and the cleansing made possible by the sacrifice of God's Son. Acknowledging that we share together in the benefits of Christ's death, let us pray for genuine love and a proper regard for one another. Gracious Lord, we are not worthy to eat the crumbs from under your table, but your love compels us to draw near. We come with repentance and faith to express our need for all the benefits of your Son's death for us. Renew us in your service and help us to love one another as members of the body of our Lord Jesus Christ, in whose name we pray. Amen. We thank you, our Father, that in your love and mercy you gave your only Son, Jesus Christ, to die on the cross for our salvation. By this offering of himself once for all time, Jesus made a full, perfect, and sufficient sacrifice for the sins of the whole world and commanded us to continue remembrance of his precious death until his coming again. Hear us, merciful Father, and grant that we who receive these gifts of your creation, this bread and this wine, according to our Saviour's command in remembrance of his suffering and death, may be partakers of his body and blood. Amen.
On the night before he died, Jesus took the bread, and when he had given thanks, he broke it, then gave it to his disciples, saying, "Take and eat. This is my body, which is given for you. Do this in remembrance of me." After the meal, he took the cup, and giving thanks, he gave it to his disciples, saying, "Drink from this, all of you. This is my blood of the new covenant, which is shed for you and for many for the forgiveness of sins. Do this as often as you drink it, in remembrance of me." Come, let us eat and drink, remembrance that Christ died for us, and feed on him in our hearts by faith with thanksgiving. I'm going to invite Joe to come up and help serve, and then invite the rest of you to come up and we'll share the communion together. Let us pray. Loving Father, through faith in your Son and his saving death, our sins are forgiven, and we share in the life of his body. With gratitude for all your mercies, we offer ourselves to you as a living sacrifice. Through Jesus Christ our Lord, send us out in the power of your Spirit to live and work to your praise and glory. Amen. Let us stand and sing our final song, Rock of Ages.
Rock of Ages, cleft for me, let me hide myself in thee. Let the water and the blood from thy river.
sin could not atone. Thou a Save and Thou alone. Nothing in my hand I bring, simply to Thy cross I cling. Make it come.
Our Lord truly is a rock, cleft for us, despite our sinfulness, despite our failings. In His great love, He has sent His Son to take that gospel message out, to share it with the world, of the great rock which has been cleft for our salvation. We've been taught and told so much today. We are living in a sexual revolution, but this has happened before. May happen again. Either way, our gospel stands and our God is true. Let us go out faithfully remembering all that our God has done for us. Amen. God bless. Have a great week. See you here next Sunday. Next Sunday, there'll be no tea and toast today. The Ludgates are unfortunately unwell. Tea and toast will be on next Sunday morning. So just a reminder. Have a great week.